Feels like Wednesday, doesn't it?
Ah, the sounds of trumpets. Be still, my heart.
Just kind of get you in the mood for a Wednesday. It's hump day.
I feel like even in August when we take time off from this, Brent, I should have that just playing on Wednesday mornings in my life. I feel like I need that on a playlist somewhere. So, good morning and hello to everybody who's joining us in the chat from all over the place, including Sligo, from Anchorage, Mason, Ohio, Utrecht, Nebraska. Wow. I'm joining from Eastern Ontario, just outside of Ottawa. Headquarters of the amazing Domino Learning Systems. All right, enough dancing. Let's get serious.
Yeah, seriously.
Yeah, no kidding. All right.
Work on that little bit in the beginning there.
Yeah, yeah. We got to work on our patter. I think that's what they call it in the professionals.
We'll get it next time.
Yeah, we'll figure it out. You know, another 100 episodes and we might be good at this eventually.
We might actually figure this out. Hey, we got a guest this morning, Chris. Who are we talking to today?
We are talking to the amazing Christy Tucker, who is joining us from North Carolina, where it sounds like she's about to have an absolutely perfect weather day.
Absolutely. It's going to be about 70 and dry and sunny this afternoon. So.
Absolutely lovely. Absolutely lovely. So for the folks who haven't met you before, Christy, or don't maybe know about you in the socials and the larger digital world, give us a little bit of an introduction to yourself and a little bit of a bio and how you got into this world, because we're always curious about all of our e-learning heroes, their origin stories.
Absolutely. So my name is Christy Tucker, and I am my title now that I'm using is Learning Experience Design Consultant. I own a business called Cinead Learning, and I've been an independent consultant since 2011. Prior to that, I've worked in both corporate and higher education environments, and many people know me through my blog. That's where I originally got to know Brent, actually, is through blog and social media. I've been blogging since 2006, and I'm on Twitter and LinkedIn and Reddit and other places where people may have seen me as well. But I specialize in particular in doing scenario-based learning and using scenarios and stories to make learning more engaging.
Very cool. Very cool. So more than just simply taking PowerPoints and making buttons on them to go forward.
Correct. I have a blog post called "No, I won't tweak your PowerPoint."
Nice. That's very brave of you in the current market situation.
Yes. So,
and so we have a, you know, what we're talking about today is the cost/time of creating e-learning. And you were sharing a story when we were in the green room waiting to go on about, you know, someone recently who asked you and said how much time/how much cost, etc., and then it seemed like a surprise, which if people have never had to experience the creation of something as an online course before, it can often be a bit of an eye opener for them.
Absolutely, and I think that part of why this question probably has come up is because as everyone is suddenly moving online and there is this sort of emergency remote training going on, which is not necessarily full e-learning, but the people often think that they can get the full online experience, but have grossly misjudged how much time it is. Mm-hmm. And so I think part of the push to have some benchmarks to judge it on is to be able to go back to people, to those prospective clients or internal stakeholders. It doesn't mm-hmm. necessarily have to be external for consultants and freelancers to say, yeah, this actually is not a really quick thing to do it well. Anyway, can we do something really quick? Sure. Is it going to get the results you want? Probably not. If we throw something together.
Mm-hmm. It's like, go ahead.
Brent. You go ahead.
No, you go ahead. I was just going to kind of steer us towards how we figured this out. That we should probably talk about this, because after so many episodes of having conversations about e-learning, I had completely forgotten about this side of the conversation,
until people started talking about it. And I will share Christy's blog post, because when I started searching for it, I was familiar with Brian Chapman's research, which is now probably pretty old, and Carl Kopp and Robin DeFelice's ATD research. And Christy mentions those in this blog post. And that's pretty much it. Not a lot of other people talk about it or have figured it out. And I think it's important for us to maybe bring it up again. And those of you in the chat, if you feel like there's other answers to this, it's a complicated question, is it not?
I mean, I think that, you know, we have these benchmarks, and I do still use Chapman's research in spite of the fact that it's old. I would certainly, I mean, I make some tweaks to it, and that's part of what in that blog post where I go through sort of his benchmarks and then adjust it. In reality, none of these industry published benchmarks are going to be as good as if you do time tracking for yourself or your team with your processes. That's always going to be more accurate than any sort of industry benchmark. And so that's really what you should do, because, you know, Paul just asked a good question here of the what part of the process is included in development, and how you define things is going to make a big difference. How do you define things? What do you include in analysis? Are you looking, you know, just the straight development from, you know, you get provided a storyboard and then you're looking development. And I've seen some of those. There are a couple of other sources on that. Icon Logic, Kevin Siegel has also talked about that in most development tools, it's about 2 hours of development for one finished minute is what he thinks for development. But, or, you know, are you thinking a simple development tool? Some of those are really heavily templated. Then maybe it's down to 1 hour.
It's hard to say, because, and Jan brings up a good point too. There is the levels of e-learning, right? That I noticed when I was doing a little research on this, there's two conversations get kind of mixed into this. And that is like the level of complexity, simple versus complex, when you talk about e-learning, or I guess we should probably define that too. I mean, heck, I mean, this could just go down the definition rabbit hole for sure,
right?
You know, and try to figure that out. I think that's why these estimates get very murky, because there's so many different variables.
This is it's the kind of question when someone says, how long will this take? And the answer can only ever be initially, it depends, which is, yeah, you know, the wrong answer. Nobody wants to hear that. And they're like, well, you know, or what have you. And certainly both the ATD, Carl Kopp, Robin DeFelice piece and the Brian Chapman piece. So things that I've relied on in the past, what I value about them is that they actually do spell out the range of things. And then people go, oh, now I get it. In looking at that kind of a thing. Christy, when someone says to you, how long will this take? What, besides the fact of saying it depends, what's your first step with someone, let's say somebody who's new to e-learning altogether, not hasn't experienced the making of something like this before?
So if it's a prospective client for me, and again, any of these things could be internal stakeholders too, that, you know, ideally, we're all having conversations about what's the business problem that we're trying to solve and what's the metrics, and figuring out, is e-learning even the solution, right? That's what we should all be having at the beginning of the conversations. We know that that isn't necessarily what actually happens in real life. And certainly I've, for whatever reason, had quite a few clients lately who have been in the, we're selling professional development and it needs to be an hour or those sorts of things where, okay, some of these things are an hour. And so some of this, if it is like Richard's question of, you know, the client wants the estimate up front. If they really want something up front, you may be better off doing some sort of short road mapping or discovery and essentially doing the analysis phase before you determine what the actual estimate will be. because mm-hmm. I think that that's part of what needs to happen. And so sometimes, if especially if the client really has no clue, has never done e-learning before, that I want to go have the time to go through their content. You know, it's often a conversion from a face-to-face training to an e-learning. So that means spending the time going through materials, or in some cases, watching videos of live training, doing some of that. So I think that that's sometimes how you can get through it. But you are at some point going to have to then ask those questions. What's the level of interactivity? What are we looking at? When you say e-learning, what do you mean by that? Are you envisioning PowerPoint in a quiz? Are you envisioning something that is interactivity every 4 or 5 slides? Are you envisioning something with a branching scenario or something nonlinear? Are you envisioning something that is works on all devices and is responsive? Are you envisioning something with a bunch of gaming? Are you, when you say e-learning, do you actually mean virtual instructor-led training with a web conferencing tool? So, you know, all of those questions are, I think, part of that analysis. And I find that there's part of that analysis process and that road mapping or discovery or whatever we call that at the beginning is often educating the client or the stakeholders as to what these different things are. Having samples of this is what a level one looks like, or a level two, or a level three. Chapman, in his research, has definitions of those levels. But again, just like time tracking and time estimates, if you can show people, this is what level one looks like for us, this is what level two looks like for us, for me, or for our organization, this is what this is. And so I think samples are often more useful than a description of things, because the language often gets in the way. We're so inconsistent about how we use these terms in our field, even among ourselves. What do we mean by e-learning?
Right.
that samples of, let me show you what I mean by level two, is probably, I mean something where we're doing stock images and animation and a fair amount of animation, and we're doing about 25% interactivity, gets us closer. That's what I mean by level two. But if I've got a little sample of that, I think it's even easier.
It also comes to talking about what types of people we need on our teams too, right? Because a lot of times that's the cost as well. It's like, if you want, you know, there's the instructional designer. If you've got one person dedicated to just doing that, and then perhaps you have to, you know, the artist, the graphic designer coming up with all of your images. And then there is maybe a video person and, you know, all of the elements and the team members that are on it. Or if you're talking about one person trying to do the whole project as a sole consultant for you, that kind of helps. That kind of varies everything too. Yeah, narration, scripting, writer, like if you, because some projects you'll hire just somebody to be, make sure the writing is good and well edited and all of that. And so it can ratchet up projects, and different companies like to produce in different ways and at different levels of quality. So it's hard to really compare those apples to apples unless you're extremely specific in what you want and you know what you paid for in the past, I think.
Right.
There's I was just gonna say the couple of people have phrased similar questions. Norman says, statement I use is, I can tell you the truth and tell you I don't know, or you can find someone who's going to lie to you, in brackets, stated in a more politically correct form.
Yeah.
And then Lori says, the metaphor I use is to ask back, well, how long does it take to fix a car? You have to diagnose, spec it out, et cetera, and then you could estimate cost time based on experience. So,
yeah. And the building a house metaphor that I also saw someone shared in the chat is another good one of the, you know, how long does it take to build a house? The answer is it depends on what you need, where you are, and what you do.
I like the house one because I've often said, you know, 1,500 square feet, is it 1,500 square feet with basic carpet or is it 1,500 square feet with marble floors? You know, it's not even just the size, it's the parts, you know, the expectation of the different the finishing touches in that way. So
the other piece that often gets left out of these conversations, besides the total time of what's the hours of active time on it, there's also this question of elapsed time of how long does it take between, you know, when you start and when you finish, because a lot of that is the, how available are you for reviews? And, you know, if you have one reviewer, the project is going to go a lot faster than if you have 10 reviewers. And it's not that it's 10 times more hours. It's probably each of those 10 reviewers is going to spend 1 hour, and then you're going to spend much longer actually making changes, and you have to get all those reviewers to agree. I think the multiple reviewers is another place where projects get derailed, and that again the elapsed time depends so much on that.
So Dr. Jim says it's a big trap.
It's a trap.
And I agree. It's a tough conversation to get stuck into, but this is where we have to navigate the soft skills, our soft skills expertise within our industry, right? We need to figure out how to strategically have those conversations with all of those stakeholders and figure out how to manage trade-offs. I think at the end of the day is what this really comes down to. It feels like what we're saying, right? Because it's like, well, we could either employ a graphic designer and that's going to ratchet up the cost, and it's probably also going to ratchet up the amount of time the project takes, or we could just go get some stock illustrations, do the best we can with what we've got out there in the kit that we've purchased. That'll shorten our time and reduce cost for having custom stuff. Is that okay? You know, and then you just have to kind of have those levels and the negotiation and figure out where you can push and pull where what they're happy with. And unfortunately, one of the things I discovered was is that they don't even know until you start to create stuff, which is why I loved your point about having examples and needing to, you know, show them this is a $20,000 project. This is an $80,000 project. This is a $250,000 project.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, I think that that's true. And sometimes the answer is that yes, bringing in somebody who's an expert will end up being potentially cheaper and faster. It is faster and cheaper for me to get a professional voiceover person than to do it myself. I don't have a great, I have an okay microphone. I have an okay setup, but I don't have a professional studio, and I'm just not very fast at editing audio. Whereas I can, and it's going to take me more takes. So if you're paying me hourly, you're better off hiring a professional, even if their hourly rate were to be higher than mine, which it probably isn't anyway. You know, you should hire the professional who has the studio, who has the equipment, and who is fast and efficient with those tools. And so I think that that's, you know, sometimes, you know, you brought up the graphic designer. Maybe you are faster having the graphic designer. Maybe the elapsed time is shorter because the graphic designer can work on it at the same time as an instructional designer's doing scripting. And maybe they can work in parallel. So even if your total hours are up, maybe your elapsed time is shorter.
Just for reference, I've dug out a link to some of the Brian Chapman info as well as the ATT article, because there were some questions in the question panel about where those, we're talking about levels. What do you mean by it? So those are sort of our touch points here, those two sets of publications there. So
You know, the art's going to depend a lot on what type of art they're asking for too, and the audience, right? If you're doing high school, maybe you want some illustrations, some fun, you know, illustration type stuff. If you're doing corporate-y type stuff, maybe you want something a little bit more professional looking, some clean lines, some real, you know, some standard sort of graphic design. Maybe you want images, and do you have to go on site? What if the training is very unique and it's about a product, like a big machine of some sort, and you have to fly out and do a photo shoot, or you have to hire somebody closer to the project and you have to explain to them what kind of shots you need for the training or whatever. I mean, it's the variety within each category can vary greatly as well and completely change the cost of a product. You know, one person's $50,000 project is not going to end up being the same as another person's $50,000 project because of all of those variations in what's needed and what they want. But it's interesting to try to get close, at least for us to, because you got to start somewhere, right? You can't just, you know, throw a dart at the wall and go, yeah, that's how much I'm going to charge.
Right. I mean, okay, so yes, the answer always is going to start with it depends. So, you know, in the long run, I mean, my recommendation would be that if you're not tracking your time on projects, please start today. Start with a time tracker, figure out, and the right tool to use is whichever one you'll use consistently. Mm-hmm. I have a spreadsheet on my blog that you can, you know, download and use my template, but any time tracking tool is good. And then get your data over the long run. That's the ideal. But if you don't, then at least starting with these benchmarks, that gives you a starting point so that you're not just making something up. So, you know, it gives you a place to start with people and to show people that, okay, when I say it's going to take 180 hours to develop 1 hour of interactive e-learning, see, this is kind of in line with this industry benchmark. So you can know that, okay, I'm not that far off of this. Or you can say, okay, I think we can do this for 150 hours or 120 hours because we're going to save time in these areas, because you only have one reviewer and because we've got, you know, we're going to not do so much with graphic design. We're going to use all stock photos. And to do those things. So you can, I think the benchmarks are helpful in giving your own test time estimates credibility too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's how we've often used them, is to say, here's a couple of outside sources that have nothing to do with us, and take a peek at those, and you'll see where we fall, you know, where our ballparking, at least to get started, is going to fall in those ranges. So. And that actually, those two articles too end up, you know, you're talking to someone, but it gives them something to take back to their bosses too, that validates what they're talking about, so that they're not perhaps feeling like they're going to be, they're being bamboozled or what, you know, there's validation there from external, you know, sources or authorities or whatever that they can take and say, look, we're, you know, this is what it is, or this is the range of what it can be, et cetera.
Yeah, the execs like to see numbers, whether they're legit or exact or on the mark or just kind of ballpark, at least they see something. Mm-hmm. And it'd be interesting if people would be willing to share what their numbers end up being. That's why I was really impressed, Christy, with your blog post, is that you were so willing to say, this is kind of how I modify, you know, my time and schedule based on all these things. You know, here's kind of where I fall in the greater scheme of things, and I think it'd be interesting. And I think the ATD report kind of took into consideration feedback from a survey of some sort. And so that's kind of how they got to the numbers. But I wonder if we could, you know, get to that point again. And maybe is it time for another sort of collecting of the data and seeing how things have changed?
Yeah.
Anybody
yeah.
in the chat from ATD want to try to figure that out?
I mean, I think it would be interesting to see. I mean, one thing about the ATD research is how much those numbers have changed over time. And although, I mean, I still use the Chapman numbers, even though they're not real recent, I find as a starting point, it's still useful, partly because he has ranges, you know, he has that average of, okay, a level two e-learning is going to be 187 to one, I think is what that is. Is that right off the top of my head? And 184 to one is his, you know, middle of the road level two. But there's ranges of sort of, even within a level two, there's a low end and a high end. And I think the other reason I like the Chapman ones is that it does break down, okay, what are we talking about for needs analysis? What are we talking about for the instructional design? What are we talking about for visual design? You know, Chris has asked in the chat about, like, what are we defining as development? And I think Chapman's data does do a good job of breaking down sort of what percentage goes to each component. And so you can sort of look at, well, okay, can we save time in visuals, for example? Or can we, you know, save time in something else in this?
Right. And we got a good question that Joe pointed me out to. Thank you, Joe, by the way. Always good to see you in the chat. Pointed me up to Shonda's question, and she says, thank you for sharing Christy's blog. Love the time tracker. And I'll second that. Thank you, Christy, for sharing all those resources with everybody. Appreciate that. Her question is, I see you have this by project, but in our case, a project may consist of 30 to 40 deliverables when scaled to large volume onboarding. How to help those who want to estimate the average of e-learning versus virtual instructor-led training versus instructor-led training builds.
Okay. So I think for a bigger project, assuming that they're all sort of related, you've got, so you, there is some economy of scale in an onboarding like that. You're going to take some time to do some audience analysis, figure out your audience and what their prior knowledge is. You'll probably have some time saving in creating a template and your look and feel and what kind of images you're doing. Maybe you will have a graphic designer, I would say, for something that large, you know, some graphic designing, but maybe you can reuse assets. So there should be some economy of scale for something really large like that. I wouldn't say that an average of e-learning plus VILT plus ILT is a useful number. You probably need, with any sort of blended learning, I think doing the estimate means you have to figure out how much of each component it is, because blended, the right blend varies so much. So you can do an estimate of e-learning. You can do an estimate of the VILT. I saw somebody like Joe had shared Cindy's work on that, saying about like 21 to 1 for an VILT kind of training, which is probably 20 to 30 or 40 is, I mean, I've seen it go higher depending on how much you're doing, but somewhere in there. So the VILT is one set of things. The ILT, that is the, you know, the standard old 40 to 1 kind of thing. If you know your ratios of what's self-paced e-learning, what's VILT, what's ILT, you can then make estimates of those components. Again, there is some economy of scale when you're doing a larger thing. I had years ago for when I was an employee, where we had a year-long training program that was a combination of, especially in the first 3 months, they were doing video training and live with instructors. There was some VILT. There was some group projects with people in local offices. And yeah, the estimate for that is based on each of those components. You probably, I would say, as a really rough number for a big scale project, you can probably take off sort of a 30% because there is some economy of scale. Yeah. Vice versa, if you're doing micro learning things where you're looking at little 5 and 10 minute things, 12 5-minute videos is more work than creating 1 60-minute e-learning. Because you have to be so tight when you're doing micro learning, every word counts. And especially if they're different kinds of projects, I find that micro learning tends to be about 30% higher than those benchmarks, at least as a starting point. If I have no other data to tell me otherwise, I would probably do, plus 30% for a series of micro learning things, unless I think that there is going to be, again, some of that economy of scale of, okay, this really is three little modules that make up three 20 minute modules that really make 1 60 minute thing. It's not really micro learning. It's, but if you're doing a separate review cycle for each one of those 15 or 20 minute modules, you probably need to add for that. So, yep.
I'd like to know if Jack shared with them her tracker, harvest time tracker. So anybody else who's got other tools that they use for tracking, et cetera, toss some ideas in there. Let's share those about. And I'm thinking as we're talking here, like this is obviously a consultant level conversation that happens at the start of every, new client project. It'd be interesting to know if folks who work within an internal team also face this kind of a question a lot, because I feel like it may be less common in that world, but I might be surprised as well that, how often if you work in a training department, are you asked, how long is this going to take? Toggle.com, Cheryl's suggesting as one. That's free. Free's good.
I've heard Toggle and Harvest. Timular is, I think, one of the other ones that I've heard people talk about. And even if you're an internal employee and you're paid salary, it's still worth doing time tracking, because if you're a salaried employee, you still can't do 18 projects at once and you still can't get them done in 2 weeks. So you still only have so many hours. I do suggest that even for internal people. Okay. I think that if you're internal, the time estimates is partly a matter of how you use your resources. How many projects can you handle at once? How long are people going to be doing things? I mean, most of us are probably working on multiple projects at a time. I always try to have a couple of them ideally staggered. So I'm writing something for one project while I'm waiting for reviews on something else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think that even for internal, you can do that. It is not necessarily that you're going to internally report the hours to an internal stakeholder, but you will probably have to do elapsed time because you need to know, is this a project that can be done in 1 month? Is this a project that can be done in 3 months? Is this really a 6 to 9 month project, because you've got, that big project of 30 to 40 assets, which is probably going to be a 9 to 12 month kind of project. So,
And certainly the immediate reaction from several folks in the chat was, yes, we're asked that all the time. So, but it just felt like maybe we were thinking too much in this conversation along the lines of, consultancy type work. So yeah, a couple of other ideas being thrown in of, just using spreadsheets. Lori talks about using just her calendar, but then transferring that to Jira work logs at the end of the day. So different tools that people use, depending on, I guess, even internally, what things your organization has in place too. Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Just checking out the other things. Parker's got a question, which we haven't really talked about, but what percent contingency do you add, in your estimate?
Saul Carliner, in his book on training design basics, talks about that contingency. I wish I could remember it off the top of my head. But he basically had levels again of if it is content that's very stable and the SMEs and the reviewers are all available, it's maybe a 10 to 20% contingency. If it's you know, moderately, you know, if it's a somebody who hasn't worked with e-learning before, and, or the content is a little unstable, then you might do a 25 to 50%. And he says, if it's very unstable or there's other reasons to be worried, that you might do a 50 to 100% contingency. So, you know, that's certainly the case of the, if you're doing the software training and the software still under development and subject to significant changes, you need more buffer. If it's other, you know, content that might be changing more, or again, if they've got lots of reviewers or you've got other reasons, there are certainly other reasons why I might do a higher contingency. I had a project where we had two lawyers as the SMEs and they needed to agree on the exact wording of everything.
150% markup right there. Don't even have to just tell me.
I know. I mean, I love them both. They were both really great SMEs and really had valuable feedback. But the elapsed time on that project was significant. So I think it's
speaking of elapsed time. Shannon mentioned, what's the best way to estimate elapsed time?
As always, the best answer is going to be, what is it in your team and your process? I would say never assume that you are going to, or that anyone is working 40 hours a week on a project. You have to assume that people are spending some time on email, that they're in meetings, that there is some inefficiency. So you can take your hours and you can do some weekly thing. Even for a full-time salaried employee, I'd never assume that they're spending more than 32 hours a week on a project. Because I think that there's just that kind of inefficiencies.
Admin and stuff.
And it's admin. And frankly, don't you want your people doing some professional development or attending Idiotic on Wednesday mornings, or, you know, like whatever. I mean, you know, there's, right. You want to leave the time for them to do some of those things. So probably 32 hours a week as a maximum, even for a full-time employee, if you've got multiple, and then you can sort of work it out of, you know, for each person who's got it, figure out those hours and do it out for weeks. You know, leave a, you know, are your reviews 3-day reviews or do you give them 5 days? Is this somebody who tends to, when you give them 5 days for review, that they take 10 days? And you can sort of build that into your schedule. I'm old school and still like my Gantt charts for figuring out projects. And I do literally, you know, like, okay, I think this is going to be 5 days for this task. And I have my spreadsheet and my Gantt chart and my work breakdown structure, and I figure it out that way. And so I think spelling out each one of those tasks, spelling out, you know, if you have multiple rounds of review, I think it's really helpful for clients, internal or external, to see that structure of, okay, we do one round of review, you take 5 days, it takes me 3 days to make the changes. Then you do another round and you take 5 days again. And here's how much that pushes that schedule out.
Mm-hmm.
That's, I think, helpful in that respect. Jack, the Saul Kalliner book that I mentioned is Training Design Basics. It's an ATD published book. It's very much a textbook for people who are beginning in instructional design or training design, but it does have some useful references. I liked that thing on the adding more fudge factor with the contingencies to things.
Mm-hmm. There's a couple of questions in the question. It probably, they give us a good chance to sort of maybe bundle all of this up. Kim's asking, what's the best strategy to convince a stakeholder that the time estimate provided is actually how long it might take? So many people do not believe, or they insist on reducing the time by an unreasonable amount. And then Chris added a parallel or a similar question. What do you say to a customer who needs to build super fast thanks to the new normal, but to do it well, you need to coach them to be patient? What's the solution? some of the thoughts I had on those, the sets of data, the Chapman data, the ATD data, at least gives you a framework to say, here's the world, you know, mm-hmm. And set your expectation just on the build hours. And then like you've just described things like Gantt charts, et cetera, which lay out the actual time that things actually then take to take those 80 hours of development. But how does that translate into a calendar? And if they don't believe it, they might be in for a surprise.
Yeah, I think at the end of the day, I think building, being able to show people something, right? Like even if you've got a sample Gantt chart from a past project, and if you're new to this, if you're like maybe new to being a consultant, maybe you just got furloughed or something and you're trying to get into consulting, just look at all these numbers and talk to a whole bunch of other people and just kind of make one up for yourself. And just so you know, you can look at it and go, okay, this is kind of what a project might end up looking like. But then if you can actually show real projects that you've done and say, this is a project that cost this much money because of all of these different reasons, but we can do this same type of thing for you cheaper if, you know, you don't take 8 weeks to go through the review process. If you get it right, you know, in the first week of the design and they're on a boatload, you know, and you've got all those different areas in that wiggle room to go through. So I think having pictures and visuals to show people, I think really does help move the ball in negotiations.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's moving into that whole world of project management too, which is the well, you know, one of the other hats that we always end up wearing in this world too. So speaking of elapsed time, we're kind of reaching our predicted estimate of this particular project this week. Christy, thanks so much for joining us. Toss your contact details in there. I think we did have a link to your blog post earlier thrown in there, but places where people might want to connect with you. And thanks so much to the folks in the chat. Have been throwing in some lots of great thoughts and other angles and supplemental pieces of this. So much stuff. I'm going to be going back and copying down a couple of things that I saw go by there too as a review for myself. So yeah, as Jack says, you rock, Christy. Thanks so much for joining us. And thanks to everybody for making the time with us here this week. And we will see you again next week here on Instructional Designers in Offices Drinking Coffee at Home.
Brought to you by Domino.
Brought to you by Domino. Yeah, there's a button at the bottom if you're looking for more info on Domino. So awesome. Thanks, guys. Have a great rest of the week, and we'll talk to you guys again next Wednesday.
Thanks for having me.
Good to catch up with you.
Bye.
Here we go.
It's the Zoom.